I see a great nation upon a great continent, blessed with a great wealth of national resources. Its 130 million people are at peace among themselves. They are making their country a good neighbor among the nations. I see a United States.
John Moffatt and Frank Nichol met at Prescon Steel Company in Portland back in the 1930s. And during those tough times, most of the construction work was done by the government and or school districts. So they were providing steel for their buildings during the Depression. They were both in their 30s. John was not married. My father had myself, I was the older brother, and Jack was 3 years younger. Then in 1940, my father was contacted by the Guy F. Atkinson Company, and they had a contract with the U.S. Navy to build a new naval shipyard, a naval base at Long Beach, California. There wasn't anything on Terminal Island at the time, so it was really starting from scratch. The Navy didn't have enough people to actually manage the project, so they said, well, build it like the Philadelphia Naval Shipyard. Here's an outline of what we think the dry dock should look like. But you're going to have to adapt it to the site. And besides the dry dock, we want propeller shops, and we want big industrial shops. We want outfitting piers, berthing piers. And the next project was Port Hueneme. And John was the chief engineer on that turnkey project for the Navy outside of Oxnard, California. After Port Hueneme was pretty well along, they also helped build the Seal Beach Naval Weapons Station and then Los Alamitos Naval Air Station. So with that background, when the war was over, they hung out their shingle and started Moffatt Nichol Engineers. The first place of business was my mother's dining room table. They both admired and thought very highly of the other's skills. My father was the engineer's engineer and a very good salesman, but an engineer first. And John Moffatt was a very good salesman, but a salesman first and an engineer second. Their first office was in the Hartwell building on the corner of Pine and Ocean. They were there for about a year, year and a half, and then they moved up the Crest building. They had three floors of the Crest building. They had some other people that came down from Truscon Steel. Gordon Murray, good engineer, he was their office manager. Jack Ruth was their chief estimator. Rube Stadler was the person that did the bookkeeping. They got a job for doing the Anaheim Street Bridge for the city of Long Beach, and that was the first welded steel bridge in California. Before that, everything had to be riveted. They got their first waterfront job in 1950, repairing some fender piles. They realized that what you really had to offer a client was just your knowledge and your integrity and making sure you did a good job, making sure that the client's needs were met. I graduated with a Bachelor of Civil Engineering and came to work for the company in 1959. We were doing work for the Navy and other industrial projects in Southern California. In the old days, we didn't have too many project managers. So I was both a designer and a project engineer. My brother was working for a Guy F. Atkinson at that time, and Jack was always interested in marinas. My father talked to my brother and said, why don't you come work for the company? And Jack said, great. And we both went down to Huntington Beach and started the design and the construction of Huntington Harbor. And Jack probably worked more on marinas and waterfront projects than anybody in the company at that time. Jack was the number one marina expert in the world. The J.L. Desmond Bridge was a great win for the company back in 1963. It was the successor to the old floating bridge between Terminal Island and Long Beach. And if you've ever seen the movie Mad, 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 Mad World, you'll see them chasing over this bridge and cars going up and down that you had to go across this bridge. The Port of Long Beach decided that they'd have to put a bridge with about 165 feet clearance so they could get some of the larger ships back to the back channels. It was done for $13 million, and I think our fee was about $900,000. In the early 60s, John Frank decided to invest in some property there on Wardlow Road in the Bixby Knowles area. It was on Wardlow and Pacific. At that time, we had architects working for us. It was done in-house. A fellow named Ferris Wankier was the architect. And we built it during 66, 67, and then we moved out to Wardlow in November of 1968. I established a great friendship with a fellow named Pete Douglas, who was my client. After Huntington Harbor, we did a project in Montreal, Canada called Nuns Island. piece of property, about 1,000 acres in the St. Lawrence River, and working with some great architects, Mies van der Rohe, Phil Brabrow, Stanley Tigerman in Chicago. I think any successful company has to have a culture that fits their philosophy and their method of doing business. And our philosophy is that we want to give the client more than he or she expects, that our people grow, that they learn, and that they feel that they're contributing to society as well as taking care of their families. In 1971, my father passed away, and in 1975, John Moffatt died. That's when I took over the company. In no way could I replace those two gentlemen. I was very sobered and realized I had a job in front of me. Things were a little slow in 1975. We got some work from the city and the ports. We also got some Navy work. The biggest change, I think, was a sense of urgency, because you don't ever like to lay off people. I had to change my horizon and had to look at things differently. Sterling Brockwell, who was a rank officer at Long Beach Naval Shipyard, and we were doing some dry dock repair, water quality work there at the shipyard that had to be done. And I told Brock, if you ever left the Navy, please give me a call. Maybe we can open up an office on the East Coast. That was the first office set up by Brock in Raleigh, North Carolina. At that time, American Airlines had a hub there at Raleigh. So I said, okay, Brock, you're going to have to be in the plane quite a bit, because our market, it goes from the tip of Maine down to the Rio Grande in Texas, a mile wide and about 2,000 miles long. So you're going to have to be on the plane quite a bit. So we started picking up work. Brock could not interview. And I remember going to the Navy interviews. And of course, some of these officers and civilians would say, well, where's Brock? I thought he joined your firm. And I said, well, as you know, Brock can't be here to interview, because it'd be a conflict of interest. But so he's down at the church praying that we hope that we get the project. We started opening up more offices on the East Coast and on the West Coast. I had to be concerned about everything, including the quality of the work, satisfaction of the clients, running it as a business so that make sure that there's a profit for the shareholders, and making sure that we had new people coming in and we could grow the company. And look at the whole industry and what part we were going to play in that industry. The key is really the people that you have. I think one thing that's strong about Moffatt Nichol, we like solving engineering problems, solving the client's problems, and doing first-class projects. Every job is important. Every client's important. You have to pay attention. You have to pay attention to details. I think it's important for engineers to learn how things are built. We want them to see how their project is being built. We want them out in the field to see how it can be built before they design, and understanding what the process is in getting it constructed. That's very, very important. You realize that life is finite. I asked the board to find my replacement. They picked my son, Eric Nichol, to take over, and he's gonna do a great job. He's smart, got a lot of get up and go. Everybody's happy, and he's gonna do a fantastic job. I hope I can be around to give some advice and put some wisdom on the table that I've learned.
We've been around for 75 years. We still have the same heart and soul as we did in 1945. We still put our people and our clients first, but we are very different in the depth of services we offer. We have 42 offices in North America, Latin America, and Europe. Over the years, we've expanded our capabilities, going into new areas that will enhance the built environment. From terminal planning into commercial due diligence, through simulation and emulation of marine terminals. We've expanded our transportation capabilities into rail, roadway, from our historic bridge practice. And on the coastal side, we've expanded beyond coastal modeling into beach nourishment, environmental, dredging. One of the differences with Moffatt Nichol is we truly are a company run by engineers and scientists. We really pay attention to the individual. You're listened to, you feel like you have your hand on the tiller. Being a family-run company means a lot to certain clients, because they know that you care. You're actually coming to work and working for your family history. And I think that brings a lot to what a family company does. You're actually wanting to take care of the business, and to take care of the business, you take care of clients and the people that work with you.